Welcome. I'm Julie Scroggins, Community Programs Manager West at the Tuberous Sclerosis Alliance, and your moderator for tonight's e-webinar series topic, Overcoming Hurdles, Insurance, Scripts, and Specialty Pharma. I want to thank our presenting sponsor of the 2021 e-webinar series, Greenwich Biosciences, and our Life Stages series sponsor, Upshur Smith. The TS Alliance will host monthly educational webinars on a variety of TSC-related topics of interest, featuring known experts in the TSC community. These free one-hour presentations include an open question and answer period. This series is composed of educational webinars focusing on four topic areas: life stages of TSC, transition workshops, TSC-associated neuropsychiatric disorders, known as TAND, research updates, and clinical trials. I'll go over a few housekeeping items and then we'll get started. First, everyone's microphones will be muted throughout the speakers' presentations. Questions can be submitted via the chat box and will be asked by the moderator at the end of the presentation. We'll do our best to answer as many questions as time allows. In addition, the webinar is being recorded. The camera setting by default has been turned off for all participants. We encourage you to participate on camera if you feel comfortable doing so, but please keep your camera off if you do not want to be on the recording. Next slide. Our speakers tonight will be Ashley Pounders, Director of Medical Affairs at the TS Alliance, and Jeff Krol, Vice President, Market Access and Payer Strategy at Greenwich Biosciences. I'll introduce Ashley later in the presentation, and now I'd like to introduce Jeff. Jeff Krol is a Vice President, Market Access and Payer Strategy at Greenwich Biosciences. Jeff has over 30 years of pharmaceutical experience. He has spent time in sales, clinical development, finance, business planning, and market research before moving into managed markets full-time in 1998. Jeff worked at AstraZeneca developing contract strategy, being responsible for Nexium payer marketing and leading the managed market sales team. He moved to Avanar in 2011 to lead the managed markets function before moving to Greenwich Biosciences as the Vice President of Payer Strategy, building the team and successfully launching their first FDA-approved drug. Jeff is a graduate of The Ohio State University with a master's from the University of California at Berkeley. He currently resides in San Juan Capistrano, California with his wife, Rebecca, and three children. I'll now turn it over to Jeff.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Julie, and throwing in The for Ohio State University. I appreciate that. It makes me sound much more official than I probably am. I have spent over 30 years in the pharmaceutical industry and the last nearly 20 with payers and managed markets. So I've got a lot of experience in the area and I look forward to sharing what I've done and what I know as best I can. Just know, if you put up the next slide, that this is a really complex topic, even for people who have been doing it in the industry for a long while. We tried to make it fun and turn it into this game with some hurdles and a track, if you will. And I started thinking about it and saying that maybe this is more like the steeplechase. So I don't know if you've ever seen the steeplechase, but people run and sprint and they jump over hurdles and they fall into puddles. And you really can't have a steeplechase race without some skin knees and some other various sundry problems. And I think what you're going to see when you work through the US healthcare system is we all end up having to go through obstacles and hurdles. There are times where we slip in the puddles, we skin our knees, and that's even those of us who know how this system works. So when you're trying to do the best self or your family members, it really can be a difficult thing. So I'm going to try to simplify some of it, give you some basic terms, and spend the next few minutes high level talking about what you may experience as someone who is dealing with TSC. So this is sort of our game board. We're going to start with sort of the initial symptoms and onset, talk about moving into getting treated, and then looking at the interactions with the specialty pharmacy. So if you can go to the next slide, please. So the first piece is really about the symptoms that are seen. And I thank all of the folks from the TS Alliance and have really enjoyed my time working with them. And my heart goes out to those who have to deal with such a significant disease, where a syndrome where almost any part of the body can be affected, kidneys and lungs, skin, heart, and of course the brain. And each of those has their own specialist. So it's a different specialist, a different set of medications, and quite frankly, a different problem with each one of these. So the specialist here is a neurologist with the brain. Next slide. And when you start going to a neurologist with epilepsy, you present in into their office and they diagnose you as having epilepsy and a syndrome of TSC. And they start to prescribe medicines for you. And those medicines, while they write them and it looks like a nice little direct path, you have to kind of take these little side steps to have the health plan approve it. And once they approve it, you get on this whole little roller coaster of on and off drugs and keep trying drugs and add drugs to get the best. And every time that you make a change in your therapy, something new happens with the payer causing issues. So we've got this list here of just some common jargon and words, and I wanted to go through and talk a little bit more about what those mean so that when you hear them and you're dealing with payers, dealing with your pharmacy, you have an understanding of what they really mean and most importantly, what they mean to you. So if you can go to the next slide, we'll that little eye information and we'll start talking about some of the cost sharing. So cost sharing is really about two different things. The first piece about it is that the plan is trying to incent you through financial means to choose a product they would prefer you to be on. And that's why they create this differential. And that differential is either called coinsurance or copay. So a copay is a set amount. Typically, there's multiple tiers in a copay, and we'll talk about those in a second. But one tier is often called coinsurance. So copay being a set amount, $20, $10, $50, even $100. It's a set amount. No matter how much your product costs, you go in and you pay a certain amount. Coinsurance is actually a share of the claim. So if the product costs $100, you may pay $30 because that's 30%. If it costs $1,000, you have to pay $300. If it costs $100,000, you have to pay $30,000. So it's really taking a share of the cost of the product. So the health plan does that to incent you to use other less expensive drugs that they make the cost share, the copay lower. And it also helps defray the cost of the system because you're then putting money in that goes towards them paying for the drug. A deductible is the amount of money you start the year having to pay before your benefit kicks in. Now, there are high deductible plans, and a high deductible plan means you have to put out a lot of out-of-pocket cost money before the benefit kicks in. That could be for your family, $3,000, $4,000, $6,000. And then once you pay that, everything else is covered almost 100%. There's very little additional money out of pocket, but you have to get through that first bit to get through your deductible. But even plans and benefits that aren't high deductible have some sort of $250, $500 deductible that you have to pay that out of pocket before the rest of the benefit kicks in. So that's what's meant by a deductible. Now, the good thing is in a lot of instances, pharmaceutical manufacturers are willing to help with copays, and you'd have to check with what happens in your plan, but often that support goes against your deductible. So a lot of people, you know, will hold off paying because they have a deductible, but the fact is they have to pay it eventually or they don't get care. And so you're better off using, getting through that deductible and then getting your care for the rest of the year covered. Out of pocket is the money that you pull out of your pocket and pay for. That could be a copay. It could be the cost of an office visit. It could be your deductible. It's every dollar that you put out for your care. And then out of network is the health plans have contracts with physicians, with pharmacists. And those folks have said, we'll take your patients and get more patients and we'll lower the cost of our services. And then that contract, they become in network. So if you have a physician that hasn't signed that contract, you may have to pay more because it's out of network. In terms of healthcare services, there's the PBM. So the PBM, a pharmacy benefit manager, is the group that manages your drug benefit. Sometimes they are owned by the health plan. Sometimes they are separate from the health plan. But the health plan is really covering your medical, surgical, lab expenses and is typically separate from the pharmacy benefit. Vertical integration, if you had it, it means that while operating separately, these things come together so that the pharmacy benefit and the medical benefit work against and someone's managing the overall cost and the overall health of the patient. So you have some sort of integration across all the different types of benefits you have. A specialist consult. So a specialist is a doctor who specializes in a particular disease. Neurologists specialize in neurology. Epileptologists are neurologists who have a subspecialty of epilepsy. And almost every major disease category has a specialist. And a lot of times payers require you to go to a specialist to get some of these specialized medicines. And then you've all heard genetic testing. That's becoming more and more common, not only in diagnosis. So TSC certainly can be diagnosed through genetic testing, but pharmaceutical companies are working very hard to try to use genetic testing to predict the efficacy of drugs with different patients. Finally, in the pharmacy, when you go there, there are costs and there are ways that health plans manage the costs. And they call that utilization management. And there's a lot of different ways they do that. So a pharmacy creates a formulary, a health creates a formulary, and those are the drugs that are preferred or non-preferred or not covered. And then they put them on a tier, and we'll talk about tiers in a second, but a tier is the relative ranking of your out-of-pocket cost for that drug. A generic, low-cost generic is going to be the lowest cost product. A high-cost specialty drug is going to be the highest cost product, and you should see that differential in what you pay out-of-pocket. There are electronic prescriptions now. Almost every prescription today is being sent electronic. It's been a long time since I have walked out of a physician's office carrying a piece of paper with a prescription that I take to the pharmacy. Doctors are writing it in their system and they are sending it around, sending it on to the pharmacy. And then finally, side effects. So side effects are any unintended consequence of taking a drug. And an adverse effect is a negative unintended consequence. So if you ever hear those two terms, they're not exactly the same, but it's important that you understand the side effects of a drug and what to expect and look out for. Next slide. So I know that was a little bit of a long piece, but getting that jargon's right, hopefully the game will get more exciting as we move on. And this is really, I think, what makes one of the big things that makes this complex. So you have an insurer, your employer pays for a health plan. The state pays for you to have health insurance, depending on what kind of insurance you have. So let's say you had Cigna. Well, Cigna has a relationship with the pharmaceutical benefit manager called Express Scripts. And Express Scripts does the formulary. They run the copays. They take all of the documentation needed to get a prescription through. And if your employer has signed an agreement with Cigna, then Cigna will be your benefit and Express Scripts will be your pharmacy benefit, but it's probably all on one card that says Cigna. You could have two cards, one that says Cigna for your medical and one that says, let's say, CVS Caremark as your pharmacy benefit, because sometimes employers choose to mix and match. To make matters even more complex, especially when you're talking about rare diseases like TSC, is you now have specialty pharmacies. And we're going to talk a lot about specialty pharmacies in a few minutes. But specialty pharmacies are typically owned and operated by a PBM. So Accredo is Express Scripts owned specialty pharmacy. CVS Specialty is owned by Caremark. And Briova is owned by Optum. And you have all of these relationships, but not all of these specialty pharmacies may carry the product you're looking for. And so if a product is not necessarily carried by Accredo, Express Scripts may have to go to Alliance Rx to get a product to one of their patients. And that is, in the end, what really causes a lot of the confusion that happens within this integration of our large organizations. If we could go to the next slide, but as we're doing that, I just want to remind, you know, it's a good time to think about, do you have two cards from your employer? Because if you do have two, it's important that your physician offices know about both of them, because the formulary of one card will be driving some of the decisions. The pharmacy card, and if they only have the medical card, they may be making some assumptions that just aren't necessarily true. So let's into how we make these formulary decisions. So a health plan is going to cover certain drugs, and that formulary decision is made by what's called a pharmacy and therapeutics committee, short P&T. Everybody calls it a P&T committee. It's made up of some nurses, pharmacists, mostly physicians. There are medical directors who are employed by the plan, and then are specialists who work in the community who are consultants that come in and they listen to the clinical presentations, they make votes and use their expertise to help guide what formulary decisions the committee is going to make. And they're selecting the medications. They are going through and determining safety. They're looking for how effective it is. They want to make sure the appropriations are on the appropriate medication. They want to make sure that side effects and drug interactions are considered. And they create utilization management to manage utilization so that it's an appropriate use. Now, when this team gets together, they look at the entire clinical package of the product. They look at the studies. They look at what the FDA has approved. They try to determine what's an appropriate patient. And they really lean heavily on FDA approval. It's why TSC patients had a difficult time getting Epidiolex until Greenwich did the studies, went to the FDA, and got an FDA indication. Once we're able to do that, then all the plans immediately put TSC as an indication that they would cover. So they really lean on that as sort of a self-preserving safety measure. They're not covering things off-label. When the clinical team looks at it, they look at a product and they do clinical first. So economics plays a huge role in determining how a product is covered, but before anybody touches an economic evaluation, a clinical determination is made first. And the P&T sits down and says, does this product have to be covered? Is it must? Does it maybe need to be covered? And they say may add so that the folks who do the financials can look and see and have the choice of whether they add it or cover it or how they cover it. Or we will not cover, do not add. And a do not add, it could be for safety reasons. It could be there are other products that are just as effective that cost a lot less. There's lots of reasons to do it. But they make the determination and basically put it into one of those three categories. So let's look at how these decisions are made. Step one, next slide. Step one is the clinical data. So they look at all the published data. They look at the clinical guidelines that groups like American Neurology Association, they create these clinical guidelines and recommendations. They bring in key opinion leaders. So they look at all this data, look at the FDA label, and they say, here's who has to be covered or who we can't cover. This is the basics of what's safe and effective that we know that's in the literature. Then they look at a financial piece. So they look at competitive products. If there's two medicines that do the same thing, they look at the difference in product costs and what the products do. They look at the burden of illness. How much does it cost to manage a patient? How many days in the hospital? How many ER visits? All of those are costs that hit the healthcare system that they pay for, even outside the drug. Then there's what's a unit cost. Unit cost is how much does a pill or how much does a milliliter of liquid, how much does the actual product work? That work cost. And then finally, there's discounts and rebates. Manufacturers get into relationships with payers and they offer certain discounts, make the price lower so that the product can be managed differently than if they didn't pay a discount or a rebate. For Medicaid, for instance, the federal government mandates a particular minimum level of discount for you to be covered. And to participate in Medicaid, you have to give those automatic discounts and mandatory rebates. So step one, they did clinical, step two, financial. Step three is really the execution of all that work. And so what happens in the actual management? Well, there's whether the product is gonna be a specialty pharmacy or a retail pharmacy. The tier is how much the out-of-pocket costs, where are we going to incent patients, and what are the relatively less or relatively more costly agents going to be placed in relationship to the drug that they're evaluating. And then what kind of things can we use, clinical management techniques, to ensure appropriate patients are utilizing the product in the appropriate manner. Next slide. So we're going to hit the little eye icon and come back to some more information to get deeper into. So you probably heard of a PA, a prior authorization. Basically, this is the health plan saying, you can't use this product without us certifying ahead of time that it's appropriate for you. And so your doctor has to fill out the PA. I, as someone who's very involved in my family's medical therapy, I try to get involved in PAs, and plans do not like that. It has to come from the payer, from the doctor to the payer, and the doctor has to put down the rationale, the medical evidence, why this patient is in particular is appropriate for this particular therapy. A step therapy is you have to try an alternative product before you can get this product. And many times a step therapy is not, you don't even notice it because you've already been on the product and they look it up electronically. The doctor doesn't have to write anything. when the script when the pharmacy puts the information in, the payer looks at it, they look back at your history and say, yes, you're supposed to have a drug prior. You've been on that drug prior. It sends it back within seconds to the pharmacy and says, yes, this is paid for and approved. A quantity limit is just making sure that you're utilizing the right amount. So if it's a once a day drug, you've got 30 pills in 30 days. And you're not asking for 60 or 90 on one copay. So it's just quantity limits is making sure it's appropriate use. And a medical policy is sort of the coverage guidelines, the requirements that need to be met. So you could need lab services, for instance, to prove that that the drug is being used and it's safe and you're not getting unknown side effects. You might have to get, you know, a genetic testing to prove that it's a TSC patient. Those are different ways that different things within the PA that the plan could require. So in general, cost sharing, tier one is typically your lowest cost generic drugs. It's a $10 copay, maybe five. In Medicaid, it could even be a dollar or free. A tier two is typically either an expensive generic or a preferred branded agent. A drug that the plan wants to cover, wants to incent you to use, and it's often somewhere in the $30 to $50 per prescription. Tier three is a covered drug, but it tends to be higher cost drugs. There is usually a higher copay, sometimes as high as $75 or $1 or $100, or could actually be a co-insurance where it's a percent of the cost of the drug. And then finally, the most expensive is specialty tier. We're going to get into specialty products, but if you're a specialty product, it's likely going to be on the specialty tier, and that is going to have the highest out-of-pocket cost. It's also known as tier four. Next slide. So we're going to spend some time talking about specialty pharmacies, and it's important to remember, you know, I talked about the whole steeplechase. Next slide. The whole steeplechase idea, especially pharmacy, is sort of those big puddles at the end of a hurdle. You're going to get tripped on a hurdle and you're going to fall into the puddle and then you're going to skin your knee. This is where it's going to happen. And the reason is that you can't just go to any specialty pharmacy. You can't walk in, hand them a prescription and pick up your drug. Specialty pharmacies are for high priced medications. This is where high touch drugs are managed, where rare drugs are managed. And because of that, payers have network pharmacies. They own them most of the time. If you're an Express Script, you likely have to go to a Credo. Unfortunately, a Credo may or may not have the drug that the physician wants to offer you. And the physician is looking at Cigna and they're looking at CVS and they're looking at Humana and Blue Cross Blue Shield and Medicaid and all these different patients coming into their office. And they really don't think about which specialty pharmacy is attached to which payer. And not only do they not think about that, they certainly aren't thinking about which specialty pharmacy is carrying that particular product. So they just fill it out and send it. And a lot of times they could even send it to the retail pharmacy. And that's what creates these hurdles. So if we can go to the next slide. A specialty pharmacy, it's a licensed pharmacy, just like a retail pharmacy, only it tends to be a closed door. And it's for, there are drugs that have significant safety issues. The FDA may require it to be monitored when it's distributed, and that would go through a specialty pharmacy. High cost drugs for cost management go through specialty pharmacy. If you need special handling, it needs refrigerated, it has to be mixed in a certain way. That a lot of times goes to a specialty pharmacy. Epidiolex is a product that goes through specialty pharmacy. It's a liquid and it's weight-based dosing. So everybody's on a different dose. So we use the specialty pharmacy to ensure there's not a lot of waste of the drug in the system. But in fact, we can keep the product price as low as we can because you're getting what you need and not a lot's getting thrown out. And then rare conditions, just because you can't have a drug, that 1,000 people are going to use sitting on 50,000 retail shelves. And so rare diseases tend to be treated out of a specialty pharmacy. So that's why we need to use a specialty pharmacy. Next slide. And what does that mean to you? Well, first of all, the big piece is always stay in touch with your physician's office and their staff that does this. They're often unaware of which SP, which specialty pharmacy a product is carried in, which specialty pharmacy your particular plan uses, especially if you had a Cigna health card. They think you need to go to a Credo, but you have a CVS pharmacy card and they didn't know that. That prescription could be anywhere. So staying and communicating, staying in contact with the office is so important. And then even if they got, the script could go to a retail pharmacy and you may walk into a retail pharmacy and they're going to tell you, we really can't do that. We don't carry it. We don't have it. So staying in contact with your health plan about which specialty pharmacy to use for a particular product. So when you contact your health plan or your PBM using your healthcare card and the number that's on there, make sure you not only ask what the preferred specialty pharmacy is, but in addition to that, you also are letting them know what drug you are trying to get. Oftentimes, if you go to the plan's online portal, patient portal, it will tell you what specialty pharmacy to use and where to get it. And if you call the drug manufacturer, they have what is called a hub, which is an area that creates support for patients. They often can tell you which specialty pharmacy to use. Next slide. So the script is electronically transmitted to the pharmacy. And this is, again, it'd be a lot easier if you had a paper script and walked into retail, they looked at it and said, nope, you need to send it here, and you could send it there. Because it's digital, it could go to a retail pharmacy and just sit there and no one ever follow up to know, no one ever get back. It could go to the wrong SP, and unless the SP is really good and knows what's going on, that they might not do anything with it. So again, it comes back to talk to the pharmacy, talk to your physician's office and the staff who are doing this. Understand where the script went and where it needs to go when you talk to your health plan. As much as you can do to help create those connections, the better chance you have of getting this system, getting the product through the system in an efficient manner. Once the script reaches the SP, the SP will actually call the office, get all the information, and make sure that if a prior authorization is needed, that the physician gives them the information and help facilitate sending in the prior authorization. They'll also call the caregiver or the individual patient and make sure that they understand the side effects, they know how to give the drug, any special uses, keep it refrigerated, those types of issues, and sort of set up follow-up calls, get history, make sure that everybody knows what the drug is going to do, what it's for, and then finally set up a delivery date, get help with any reimbursement issues, get the payer issues, and collect the copay or out-of-pocket costs. So next slide. So if it goes to the wrong pharmacy, it could just sit there, quite frankly. Electronically, it might not go anywhere. It could literally just be in the digital world out there. And that's why communication, as I've been talking about, is so important. If it went into the retail pharmacy, ask the retail pharmacist if they carry it, if they have it, or if they can get it. And if they can't, you may have to call your plan to find out which specialty pharmacy is being used for the plan for that particular drug, or call the manufacturer, and they can at least tell you which products or which specialty pharmacies carry their products. The pharmaceutical manufacturers typically have a limited size network. If you know you're going to have, you know, 5,000 patients, you're not going to put the drug in 50,000 retail pharmacies. You're not even going to put it in, you know, 1,000 specialty pharmacies. You're going to pick a couple people who are going to get really good and can give the highest touch, best product services for your product. But that creates on the back end these other issues of how do you get the product out and how does a physician know where to send it? And so staying again in contact will make it quicker. Once it's there, the SP will work to get the PA through. Next slide. One thing while we're switching to the next slide, I think it's really important that you think about using portals that occur for patients. A lot of the SPs have portals. Some drug manufacturers have portals. Offices have portals. If you know where to go, you can use a patient portal to get through and actually see what's happening. So if your prescription needs a prior authorization, that just means that the health plan, your insurance company, wants to make sure that the drug requested is appropriate. So if a drug is indicated for patients age 5 and up, and you're under the age of 5, they want to know that. They want to find out why would the drug be used less than what the study showed that it should be used in. They might want the diagnosis, a list of previous medications. And this is a big insight for you. You keep a history of all the products you've been on or your family member has been on and how long they were on, when they were on it. Because if you change healthcare plans, that's not in the history. If you change doctors, it's not in the history. And many times your doctor's going to have to list out the medications to get a PA approved. A PA will handle the requirements to make sure that you've tried any other drug. If not electronically, they can do it through what your physician writes. And this is a really big takeaway. If you don't remember anything else, this is the one thing I want you to remember. When a prior authorization gets approved, you will get a letter. Oftentimes, that letter is way after you find out. You'll get your drug's been approved and you've had the drug for 2 months already. They're not exactly the most timely letters, but there's one very important aspect of that letter. It will tell you how long the approval is good for. It may be 6 months, it may be 12 months, it may be 3 years, it may be forever. But knowing when the authorization ends, if you want to stay on the product, your physician needs to fill out a reauthorization form, has to go through the PA process. And having to do that when you're almost out of medicine is always a bad idea. So make note when you get your PA approval letter, what the date is, and make sure your physician knows before the PA is up to resubmit the information so that you can get the drug before you run out and you're not sitting there waiting for a prior authorization approval in an emergency where you're out of drug and potentially starting to have seizures or other issues. SPs, especially pharmacy, they'll work with the PA. They'll get it, help the provider, your physician do the paperwork. They'll get it taken care of. What they will not necessarily do is know when it is up. They will know when the PA is over and they need a new PA, when they submit your script and it says denied, PA required. And that is usually 5 days before your next script is due and is oftentimes too late to get it approved and get your script filled and back in your hands before you run out. Make sure your provider, your physician, the office has a full medical history. Keep track, let them know what it is. And the SP, they'll notify you. You'll get the drug long before the letter comes in. If it's been denied, that doesn't mean you can't have the drug. If it's been denied, it means that the general criteria set forth by that P&T committee is not met. It could not be met because your doctor didn't provide the right stuff. It could not be met because you need a medical exception, that you don't fit into those rules, but you still are appropriate. And it's called an appeal when you get a denial. The TS Alliance has resources. Manufacturers have resources. That's part of what the hub does. The SP has resources. So if you get a PA denied, that does not mean that you can't get the drug. It just means you have to work a little harder. I always say it doesn't mean no, it just means not now, but don't tell my kids that. So your SP will call you once the PA is approved, tell you payment is coming and set up the delivery. And usually then within 72 hours, you'll get the drug, the office will know you're getting it. And once that whole beginning process is over with, things really do get a lot easier because now you don't have to go to the pharmacy. It's delivered to your door and you'll see the high touch that the SPs can actually provide, the type of service that they want to provide. They really have your best interest at heart. It is a business. A lot of times people at a higher level are making decisions because they're just not close enough. And that's why it's important when you see those issues to notify the TS Alliance, call the manufacturer, let people know so that they can help you. There's a lot of people who are invested in helping you, and we just have to understand what the issue is. Next slide. So what happens if you can't afford your prescription? You have high deductible health plans out there, which require a lot of out-of-pocket costs. Again, different pharmaceutical companies, if you have a commercial plan, they have copay offset programs. They have other types of discount cards that can help with that. And in many cases, those will count towards your deductible. So, you know, if you're a commercial health plan, you're not getting, your plan is not paid by the government, then there's probably some that's out there for you. But you also have the cost of your medication, formulary tiers, co-insurance, copay. So what can we do? Well, the first thing is the specialty pharmacy is incented for you to get the drug. They get paid for dispensing the drug to you. And so they're going to help locate financial assistance. In many cases, you can call the hub, the pharmaceutical company. They will help as best they can. There are rules about when they can and can't help. We're not allowed to help with out-of-pocket costs for government programs such as Medicare. And Medicare has high out-of-pocket costs. That's just an issue that exists. But if it's a commercial payer, we have copay cards, we have discount cards, and we're getting better and better as manufacturers at understanding how to design the benefit to most help you. Almost every copay card has a maximum benefit amount for the year. At Greenwich, we decided to not make that a monthly, but make it annual. And that was because of high deductible health plans. If you need $2,000 all in the same month, but then you don't need any the rest of the year, that's fine. It's within our maximum for the year. There's also things that are called patient assistance programs. You may hear them called as PAPs. They are income-based. So if you're unemployed or have significant financial hardships, we don't want patients to go without drug. We do not want patients not getting the medicines that they deserve. We first want the health plans to cover it because you pay premiums all year long, your employers pay premiums all year long to get the benefit. But if for whatever reason you can't afford it, I think we would, in all our power, what's legally appropriate, we would try to help get the patient on the product. And I think manufacturers like that. And then finally, there are charitable foundations that are out there, particularly for Medicare members who can't afford their out-of-pocket costs, but there are charitable foundations that are out there to help support patients get a prescription. So sort of high level, it's a lot. I threw a lot of terms out there and I've been talking way too long. I really prefer to be more interactive, but in a Zoom setting, it's hard. I do appreciate you hanging out and listening, and I really hope you learned one or two things that can really make the process on your next medicine a little easier to understand, a little more efficient. And I'm going to be here for questions, but before that, I'm going to turn it back over to Julie to introduce Ashley.
Thank you, Jeff. As Jeff said, he'll be back at the end of the presentation to take your questions. And now we're going to switch gears and I'll introduce our next speaker. Ashley Pounders has worked with the TS Alliance on various projects since 2016 and has joined full-time as a Director of Medical Affairs in 2020. In this role, Ashley provides information and assistance to constituents needing help accessing clinical care and FDA-approved treatments for tuberous sclerosis complex. She's also leading the development of a new online TSC Navigator tool to help individuals and families maneuver the intricate TSC healthcare system and proactively manage their care and driving the implementation of a TSC learning healthcare system over the next few years. Ashley brings with her 13 years of experience within the nursing profession. She obtained her master's in nursing in 2018 from Purdue University and her bachelor's in nursing in 2007 from Baptist College of Health Sciences in Memphis, Tennessee. Ashley served as the lead coordinator for the TSC Center of Excellence at the LeBroner Children's Hospital in Memphis from 2016 through 2019. In 2018, Ashley played a major role in assisting with the inaugural TSC Nursing Conference in Dallas, Texas. Ashley also was part of many clinical trials and retrospective research projects. She received a DAISY Award during her time at LeBroner for facilitating process and compassionate changes to better assist the TSC patient population. In her spare time, Ashley enjoys spending time with her husband and three boys, gardening and training for the next Ironman. I'll now turn it over to Ashley Pounders.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Ashley Pounders, and Jeff, thank you so much for an excellent presentation and Julie for the introduction. As a nurse practitioner, I'm really aware of all the diversity and issues that you guys as constituents experience with medication issues and barriers through the pharmacy. Let's see. Go ahead to the next slide. A little history on the TS Alliance for those of you who are new and a refresher to those who are familiar with the TS Alliance. The Alliance was founded in 1974 as an international recognized nonprofit organization dedicated to finding a cure for tuberous sclerosis complex while improving the lives of those affected. Some of our major goals are to accelerate research, improve access and quality of care, support and empower constituents, educate and mobilize to increase investment, and build and strengthen our organization. Next slide. We have many organizational partnerships that offer resources and education information. Depending on where you are in your TSC journey, the ones listed here are outstanding resources for additional insight, education, or tools to fit your individual needs. Next slide. Transitioning into adulthood can cause a lot of anxiety and stress. We at the TS Alliance recognize this and want to provide the resources needed to encourage you to be proactive, well-informed, and guided during this phase of your journey. During the transition phase, there are many potential hurdles you may encounter. Today, we're going to focus on your healthcare and pharmacy teams. The transition phase should start around the preteen years. The first step that you can have is to start having conversations with your current healthcare team regarding the process in your state, such as for a guardianship or conservatorship. This is a legal process and it can be costly. So it's best to start early to go ahead and navigate that and be prepared on the front end. You will also have legal documentation that you would need to also give to your healthcare providers, as well as to the pharmacies that you are that you have. From a pharmacy perspective, in order to be able to continue to refill and manage your child's medication, appropriate paperwork needs to be in place with your health plan and or pharmacy. Maintain copies of all of these documents because you're going to need them throughout, as well as anytime you have a change in your healthcare plan or if your pharmacy or specialty pharmacy change. From a provider perspective, shifting care from a pediatric team to an adult team can be an extensive process. It's important to make sure these are ongoing conversations regarding the recommendations from your current team and ensuring that your new team fits the needs of not only for the patient, but for you as the family. Next slide. The TS Alliance has amazing resources available. Over here on the left with the digital resources, we have, we have digital resources, the Perspective Magazine, the TSC Matters, TSC Alert, TSC Now, and the TSC TV. You can sign up for any of these or a few of them, whichever. All of them will help you stay connected and up to date with the latest information. And over here on the right, we are extremely excited and thrilled to offer the 2021 webinar series. Today's webinar is the second of this year and the first on life stages of TSC. I also want to point out that transitioning into adulthood is a very detailed topic, and we have 6 webinars planned this year to help you navigate that process. So be sure that you're signing up for those upcoming events. And Shelley might be able to add the link in the comment or in the chat section for you guys. Next slide. The TSC Navigator. So this is a upcoming online portal that will help you, that will come out later this year, that will help guide you and your healthcare team along your TSC journey. The TS Alliance acknowledges that each person's journey is unique, therefore bridging the gap within the existing healthcare system and decreasing the barriers to care and access to FDA approved treatment is a priority. The TSC Navigator is an essential in providing accurate, up-to-date, high-quality care support, treatment coordination, and advocacy for each need for all individuals with TSC and families across the lifespan of TSC. No matter where you are in your journey, the TSC Navigator is there to find the support and guidance you deserve. Next slide. All right, given the uniqueness of the TSC journey, the TSC Navigator will also have support navigators available to help you. Myself, as well as my colleague, Joanne Nakagawa, who is the Director of Clinical Projects and TSC Clinic Liaison. We are available to help with any barriers, questions, advice, or emotional support. You can contact us, our email or our phone numbers. We also have a 7-day-a-week from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time emergency hour contact information that you can see on the slide down here. Next slide. All right, with that being said, I'm gonna turn the conversation back over to Julie to highlight our community programs.
Thank you, Ashley. The TS Alliance Community Programs team, led by April Cooper, provides an array of services to individuals with TSC, their families, and their caregivers. Our peer-to-peer community programs offer resources to help throughout the entire TSC journey. We're there from diagnosis, for help with education, transition, and all of life's stages. Our programs include community alliances. There are presently 33 community alliances throughout the country. The Adult Regional Coordinator, or ARC, program. There are currently 12 ARCs serving 8 regions in the United States. The Dependent Adult Transition Resource Coordinator, or DAT, program. There are currently 33 DATs across the United States and Puerto Rico. The Future Leader Program, formerly known as the Junior Leader Program, and there are 6 future leaders in the current class of leaders. The TS Alliance Clinic Ambassador Program, there are presently 27 TSC clinics with TSC clinic ambassadors. And finally, the Spanish Support Network. Our educational advocacy efforts include the Educational Parent Mentor Program, or EPM, and there are currently 31 EPMs in 23 states and a Spanish-speaking EPM who serves all 50 states. The Professional Educational Mentor Program, or PEM, and there are presently 26 PEMs serving all 50 states. We'll be sending out a resource document following this webinar, and that document will direct you to who to reach out to for each specific program. Or just feel free to reach out to any of us on the Community Programs team to be connected to the resources you need. We are here to provide help and hope throughout the TSC journey. Next slide. We know that pharmacy barriers are a major frustration to you, and with Jeff's expertise, we're hoping that we can answer your questions and help you navigate your healthcare needs. Please continue to send your questions in the chat box while I ask Jeff this first question to get things started. Jeff, are there any consumers on the P&T committee?
Yeah, so typically no. It is pharmacists, nurses. Nurses would be the closest thing to sort of a patient advocate on the P&T. The best way to influence that is really to go through the TS Alliance. I've talked to them about how to talk to plans, health plans, and to do more of that. And really to have your physician continue to have discussions with the medical directors in the plan that they have access to. But typically when the P&T meets, they do not have a consumer involved.
Jeff, we have another question. What classifies a drug as a specialty drug and number of potential users?
Yeah, so there is no standard way of defining a specialty drug. There's multiple pieces that make it that way. So a manufacturer will typically make the decision based on the needs of the patient. It has to do with distribution and cost of distribution. Can you afford to have it at the retail pharmacy and sit there? And then how much, drug's going to get moved? And so, and then also how much it costs. A higher priced drug is going to be managed more effectively through a specialty pharmacy. And then while, in the case of Epidiolex, when we first launched, we were a scheduled product like a narcotic. And that requires special handling and what can be done for a product. If you have a product that needs, I mentioned that, the bottle, when we send out our product, we send it out with the amount you need for 30 days. So you could have split bottles, a 1.5 bottle, 1.75 bottle. It could need to be frozen or kept cold or kept heated. All those things just drive why a product may or may not end up in the specialty pharmacy. And there's no magic number on the number of patients, but in general, 200,000 or fewer patients is considered rare in the US, and most rare drugs, most drugs for rare conditions will end up in specialty pharmacy. So if you're looking for a number, something like 200,000 or less of a patient population, that's not patients on a drug.
Thank you. Next question. For high deductible plans, will a specialty pharmacy be more affordable option? And how do you find available patient assistance programs?
Yeah, so the specialty pharmacy is not necessarily more or less affordable. It's in a lot of cases, you don't have a choice. It's dictated by the plan or the manufacturer. Very rarely is a product sitting on a shelf in a retail pharmacy and being available at a specialty pharmacy. It just doesn't happen to have it at both places. However, what a high deductible plan does is typically you have a high deductible amount that you have to pay before your benefit kicks in. Let's say it's $4,000 for a family. The out-of-pocket max might only be $6,000. So if you're using a manufacturer's copay offset coupon or program or card, copay card, that could go towards your deductible. So having the medicines go through first and get covered first with a copay card would reduce the deductible versus going to a doctor or getting into the hospital or doing an ER visit where you have to pay that out of pocket and there isn't a manufacturer or some other copay offset. So I hope that made sense, but any pharmaceutical product is better with a copay card to help potentially reduce your deductible. So how do you find patient assistance program? The manufacturers are the ones that run it. So if you're on a particular product, if you call the medical information or you call the number that's on any of the materials for any product, any of the marketing materials, the number on the box when you get it, you will talk to someone within the health, within the pharmaceutical company, and they will get you in touch with the people who need to qualify you, whether that's, you know, demonstrating your income or whatever there is that needs to be done. And I know that we and other companies as well have changed some of the rules with COVID because more people are financially struggling. So we've made it easier and have more people come through the program and make people have to go through the reauthorization less.
Thank you. Thank you to Jeff and Ashley for providing great information. We appreciate all of your time and expertise. Thank you all for participating. I want to thank our presenting sponsor of the 2021 e-webinar series, Greenwich Biosciences, and the Life Stages sponsor, Upshur Smith. To register for future webinar topics and to access recordings, please visit www.tsalliance.org/2021-e-webinar-series. Please see the chat box for that link. We'll also be happy to provide this PowerPoint to our registered attendees. Thank you all and good night.